Welcome to Study with the Best, the magazine show about CUNY. I'm Valerie Vasquez.
And I'm Zyphus LeBron. The Holocaust is among the greatest atrocities ever committed. The Nazis killed millions of people. The majority, 6 million, were Jewish. Much of the history of the Holocaust, understandably, has focused on the horrific acts committed by Hitler and his followers. But there are Holocaust survivors who want to ensure that those who perished are not remembered just as victims, but as human beings with whom we all can identify.
On this edition of Study with the Best, you'll meet a Brooklyn College professor and Holocaust survivor who's chosen to focus on humanity and not hatred.
We'll follow a CUNY BA graduate as she works on preserving the ecological balance in Jamaica Bay, and a group of aspiring politicians in a CUNY program that puts them in the seat of power.
Plus a CUNY alumni who wields a good deal of power as an executive with Colgate-Palmolive. So stay tuned.
Yaffa Eliach is a professor at Brooklyn College, the school where she was once a student. She is also a board member of the Holocaust Museum, where she created a photographic memorial to the thousands of people from her hometown in Poland who were killed during the Nazi era. But although Professor Eliach's early years were marked by destruction and death, the Holocaust survivor prefers to focus on life.
We managed to run away in an attic, and my baby brother was choked to death because they were afraid that he will cry. And the people that were hiding with us choked him to death and tried to choke me. They were afraid that I'm going also to talk and cry because the Germans came downstairs to park their motorcycles.
My mother was murdered after liberation by the local Polish partisans because they wanted our property and wanted to get rid of all the Jews who still survived, and only 36 of us survived out of 3,500 from the town. So I left in 1944 because my father was arrested by the KGB, by the Russians. So I left and I was barely 7 years old as a child, and I managed myself to run away.
I introduced the Holocaust to President Ford on October 12, 1976. President Carter took the idea of President Ford, and he called me up to become a member of the board that he established to build a museum in Washington. And he did send us to Europe in 1979 when I was on a plane from Warsaw to Kiev, because we are going to stand in Kiev, where the Jews were murdered by the Einsatzgruppen and the mobile killing units. And I suddenly realized that somewhere below where we are flying, below our plane, is the small town where I lived as a small child till the age of 4. That I wanted to go back to the place where indeed I lived as a child, to the shtetl of Eschwitz. I can't tell you what it meant to go back there. As I was standing on the mass grave, it was amazing. I didn't see them as dead people. I saw them as living people in my photos. And I felt that they were holding on to me and talking to me. They were above me, below me, around me, and say, show the people the way we looked. You have the photos, and now you see us. There on the grave, my idea of the exhibit in Washington was born. How to present it, that you should stand in the middle and the people should be, the photos should be below you, around you, just what I feel on the grave. The exhibit became extremely popular, and I was so pleased that people, you know, were looking at it and said, we never realized that the Jewish people were normal people just like us, because all the photos that we saw were always photos from concentration camps and ghettos and dead bodies and concentration camp uniforms. We are so happy. Until today, it doesn't matter what ethnic group from around the globe, people identify with the photos. It looks like my mother, looks like my sister, looks like my father. It was amazing. Though I was 7 years old, I went, a Russian captain who knew me very well, and he liked my father also very much. So this captain managed to get me into my father, where he was arrested. And my father said to me, "My child, I want you to know, you must remember the Holocaust was not called the Holocaust, it was called slaughter at that time. But you must remember it exactly, and you saw everything that happened." But you must focus on life, on learning, and on love. This is the future. Do anything and everything. And indeed, I did so. As I said, I'm a great believer in life and in history. When my children were born, of course, in the United States, when they were started to walk, the first thing always I took them to great historical places in the United States. I took them all the places in the United States to see how life was built in America. And I couldn't understand why in Israel they did not rebuild anything about the past. Because when you go to Europe today, what do you see about Jewish life? Concentration camps. That's it. And therefore I felt, as long as we still can get memories, it's extremely important. And I decided to build a town in Israel, a Jewish Williamsburg of Virginia. So the future generations will be able to come, and really they can go to the synagogues the way it was hundreds of years ago, building a tremendous castle that will be a museum of every element of life. They can go shopping, they can go to school, they can go to play. Depends on the age of the people, because I believe in participating. It'll be wonderful. People would like to see what was life, not what was death only. And I think it will bring us together in a very positive way, and tourism will become not only to go to concentration camps, but also to go to see the greatness of life. Because as I said, I'm a great believer in life.
CUNY offers a range of educational options, whether you're interested in a senior college or a community college, a certificate program, or a graduate degree. You should contact CUNY's Office of Admission Services at 1-800-CUNY-YES or visit our website, cuny.edu.
The CUNY BA program allows students to attend classes on more than one campus. This was ideal for a former dancer who wanted to pursue a degree in zoology and couldn't find that major at an individual college. Since graduating with a degree in that field, she's been working at a wildlife preserve right here in New York City.
My name is Kelly Slough. I have been a research assistant here at the Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge with my professor from Brooklyn College for 2 summers. This is my second summer. I've always been passionate about the environment and animals. And, you know, after being a dancer and having such a passion for my career, I couldn't imagine going into something else that I didn't have equal passion about. And when I really started, you know, honing in on what it is I wanted to study, you just found the campuses that gave you more opportunities. And And the CUNY BA program made it easy to do that. You know, I love mud. I mean, I just like getting my feet dirty, my hands dirty. No, I enjoy that sort of thing. So, you know, it's hard for me to imagine not being outside, not being active. You know, having been a dancer, it's hard for me to imagine a 9-to-5 kind of conventional job. My professor has a hypothesis that the mussels in Jamaica Bay are so densely populated that they're creating these, what he calls berms, which are basically barriers at the edge of the marsh. And they're helping to create erosion in the salt marshes. And he wants to determine if the mussels are adding greatly to the sedimentation rate, and if so, does it make the salt marsh grow higher and therefore break off more quickly than it normally would in another estuary? So what we were doing is we're collecting a 24-hour sample of the water that's collected in a can that we've embedded in the mussels. And we are trying to extract the sediment from the water. And with that sediment, we can, by using mathematical formulas, determine what the sedimentation rate is over a year in a square meter. And then we can apply it to different, compare it to studies done in different estuaries and see if it's much, much greater. And if so, are the mussels contributing to that? It's just important because the salt marshes are such a productive ecosystem. And if they're eroding at such a great rate, they may not exist in 10, 20, 30 years. What happens? What happens to the food chain? You know, if it's the beginning of the food chain for ecosystem here and the ocean surrounding, what happens when it's gone? It scares me. Every year, it's reassuring and it's pure and it's just beautiful to me. The salt marsh is a very pure, simple ecosystem. And I just find it beautiful because it is within the five boroughs, and it's there's just so many species of birds, and it's a pleasure to come out here and be surrounded by quote-unquote nature, even though the jets are flying over and you're not really. But it would be a shame to see it, disappear.
Up on Study with the Best, on the road to Albany.
And from student leader to corporate leadership. But first, this message from the Chancellor.
Hi, I'm CUNY Chancellor Matthew Goldstein. If you're a high school senior with a B average or better, you may be able to pay half of your CUNY tuition with a City Council scholarship named in honor of Peter Vallone. We'll help you find out if you can combine this scholarship with other government funds or private scholarships so that you can attend CUNY at no cost. For financial aid and scholarship information, call 1-800-CUNY-YES or find us on the web at cuny.edu.
The best way to understand what a politician does? Well, to try a hand at it. And that's exactly what students at CUNY get to do when they participate in the Model Senate program. Students go through the rigors of being a lawmaker, from designing a bill to debating its merits on the floor of the State Senate in Albany.
The Model New York State Senate session is a unique undertaking. It is truly a university-wide program, bringing students from throughout the senior colleges and the community colleges together to learn about legislative politics and policymaking. In addition, students are asked to participate from the State University of New York, making this an interesting collaborative between New York State's public university systems.
We have approximately 60 students who are participants in the New York State Model Senate session.
They're convened for more than 20 or 25 hours of training here at the City University of New York Graduate Center to learn about policy making and the legislative process.
The training sessions were like the key to the whole thing, because that's where really like opinions were set.
Students master a training manual that is at least as large as, if not larger than, the average course packet being adopted by many faculty members today.
The manual is really divided up to provide first just basic information on what it means to be a representative from a political science perspective. Students aren't told how they should think on the issue. They're given information, and from that information they decide what their position should be, and this manual really gives them, I would say, we hope, everything that they need.
The training sessions we had, you know, we learned about democracy and the legislative process and New York government.
They are then convened in Albany in the chamber of the New York State Senate to really demonstrate what they've learned. We, you know, meet them in the morning, get on a bus, and we use the bus ride, not ironically, up to Albany as part of the training component.
Good afternoon, my fellow model students.
In the bus, it was where we became really a team, a group.
When we got up there, you know, we were ready. You know, the bus ride prepared us, it calmed us down, it psyched us up for the competition, because it was a competition. And so we went up there, we went up there to win, you know, with this democratic attitude, team attitude.
The whole building carries itself, you know, the everything is huge. You feel the weight of it, because it's been there for such a long time, and what it represents. So that's a little what scares you before you go in. You can tell by how we were behaving outside, and once we came into the chamber, we were other people.
You walk in to the Senate chamber and you feel a sense of power in the room. It just vibrates off the wall, off the gold in the ceiling, you know. So it's a feeling of, wow, this is history, and I'm in it, you know, I'm a part of it. I'm participating. Even though it's a mock ceiling, you feel like you're a real senator.
Students personify state senators in this project. They sit in the seats of the real senators in Albany. They discuss a bill. This time they discussed the commuter tax bill, which was really an issue that the students understood as city residents and could get their teeth into.
I urge you to cast your vote with a lending hand towards the city.
I make a call to all my colleagues to support the MS1.
A goal that will not be served by slapping them with an additional tax.
And I vote yay on this bill, not only because it benefits my constituency, but because I believe in unity. Remember, el pueblo unido jamás será vencido.
27 votes for the bill, 36 against. The bill is defeated.
For me, learning about issues like concerning Latino community, the minority community, it made me want to aspire in this career, made me want to pursue this career. Maybe, you know, maybe I can do something to change or help out my community.
The experience changed my views of things in many levels. Like, as I used to think, like, all politicians are corrupt, and I really got a hold of how they work by going through this, and how the system works, and understanding compromising and everything that goes with that.
though your cost to attend CUNY is low, the university still offers a full range of financial aid opportunities. Over 70% of CUNY's full-time undergraduate students receive some sort of financial aid. For information on financial aid, call 1-800-CUNY-YES or visit our website at cuny.edu. Philip Berry was a student leader and activist during his days at the Borough of Manhattan Community College and Queens College. After graduation, he remained involved in social and community issues. Now he is a high-ranking, high-profile executive with Colgate-Palmolive, one of the most recognizable companies in the world. This CUNY twofer credits his education and his activism with helping shape who he is today.
I'm Philip Berry, the Vice President of Global Employee Relations and Best Place to Work for Colgate-Palmolive Corporation. There are a number of things that I'm responsible for. Of course, the employee relations has to do with helping individuals who have different problems in the organization, working with managers and employees as they have issues regarding the workplace. But the Best Place to Work designation has to do with helping to develop programs and activities which make us an employer of choice, helping to retain, attract, and develop talent in the organization. And when I was at BMCC, it was during the Vietnam War, and probably a lot of students at that time, I was really concerned about our being over in Vietnam, and so I was involved in some of the demonstrations or the protests, you know, where we were raising concerns, you know, about our involvement over there. It was a time of high social consciousness, and that was something that began to develop at BMCC, but it really began to take hold when I went to Queens College, where I became the president of the Black Student Union there, and was involved in a number of student activities on the campus. I remember this vividly. There were 48 students in this particular program, which was called the Open Door Program, which was one of the programs that was established to try to increase the diversity on the Queens College campus. And the funds for that program were being cut. And what I did was to negotiate with the president of the college at that time, who was Joseph Murphy. The thing that I did was to open up a constructive dialogue with him, and we were able to get those students reinstated so that the program wasn't cut. My feeling about social activism is that I saw some injustices, I saw people that had needs, and I wanted to involve myself in any way to take a leadership role to help people. And that's certainly something that I'm doing here at Colgate. A lot of times people talk about change, but they're not willing to take on those changes themselves, and they're not willing to put themselves through the process where they can do that. And in fact, sometimes remember that you might have to do something completely out of the box to get from point A to point B.
Well, that's a wrap. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week. In the meantime, remember to study.
Study with the best.